Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Revenants of the German Empire, Colonial Germans, Imperialism, and the League of Nations, by Sean Andrew Wempe, read by David DeVries. When now we look back to the scattered and diverse individuals who first give expression to this idea of the modern world state which was dawning upon the human intelligence, when we appraise their first general efforts towards its realization, we need, before we can do them anything like justice, to attempt some measure of the ignorances, prejudices, and other inertias, the habits of concession and association, the herd love and the herd fear, with which they had to struggle, not only in the society in which they found themselves, but within themselves. It is not a conflict of light and darkness we have to describe. It is the struggle of the purblind among the blind. It was a league not to end sovereignties, but preserve them. H.G. Wells, The Shape of Things to Come, 1933. Introduction. A world of colonial empires, no longer their own. In April 1884, Chancellor Otto von Bismarck declared that the German Empire would join the European scramble for colonial possessions. After a year of debates in the Reichstag, Germany officially began a program of state-directed colonialism and a period of rapid imperial expansion. By 1913, just 32 years after unification of the German states under the Prussian Hohenzollern monarchy, Germany possessed the third largest colonial empire in the world, laying claim to small territorial holdings in China, island colonies in the Pacific, and huge swaths of the African continent. Although Germany was technically a latecomer to the table at which Europeans had carved up the globe, the birth and growth of the German colonial empire was the result of more than a century of German overseas scientific exploration, commercial ventures, missionary activities, emigration, scholastic orientalism and exoticism, and concerted lobbying for the government to formulate a colonial policy by German colonial interest groups. The success these groups enjoyed at having attained their goal, however, was short-lived. Within 18 months of the start of the First World War, all but one of Germany's colonies was captured by foreign powers. By 1918, the only colony Germany had partially managed to keep from Allied occupation was German East Africa, thanks to the fierce defense staged by General Paul von Lettow-Vorbeck and his troops. By the time of the armistice on November 11, 1918, the German Empire, both overseas and in Europe itself, was nothing more than a memory. After 4 years of war, with no end in sight and the loss of nearly 2 million German soldiers, Germany had had enough. A revolution, sparked on October 29 by sailors in Kiel, who chose to mutiny rather than to perish in a foolhardy last stand envisioned by the German Admiralty, had prompted calls in Germany for the end of the war, the abdication of the Kaiser, and the establishment of a democratic government. The Kaiser's abdication was announced on November 9 by Chancellor Max von Baden, who himself resigned the same day. On November 11, the same day the armistice was signed, a provisional democratic republican government was established under Friedrich Ebert, head of the Social Democratic Party of Germany, SPD. Yet as Detlef Peukert argued, the Weimar Republic did not come into being as the result of an heroic act or of an act which national mythology could represent as heroic. Rather, it was the product of complex and painful compromise, of defeats and mutual concessions. In its 15-year history, Weimar Germany faced many challenges, particularly in its early years. The new state struggled to legitimize itself domestically and encountered malcontents and critics reacting to and sometimes prompting many changes of government amid the shift from monarchy-empire to republic. Pamela Sweat and Dirk Schumann have demonstrated the processes by which the polarizing party politics resulted in a sometimes violent or extreme political culture in the form of paramilitary groups, assassinations, and even street brawls between parties. Although it would attain a brief period of stability from 1925 to 1929, the Weimar Republic experienced at least two bouts of detrimental inflation fluctuating economic conditions and agricultural and industrial production, and numerous groups placing demands on its welfare system. Weimar Germans also engaged with global shifts in political culture and communication throughout the Roaring Twenties, as well as media and cultural production more generally, creating new debates on morals, art, religion, gender roles, demographics, reproduction, and population control. Thus, the birth pains of Germany's new Weimar Republic, which was not formally established under a constitution with Ebert as its first president until August 1919, went hand in hand with the negotiations to end the First World War and the new global society that emerged in their aftermath. The Treaty of Versailles, negotiated between delegates from the victorious Allied powers between January and June 1919, redrew the map of Europe and imposed what many Germans considered to be harsh terms on the new republic. In Article 231, the infamous War Guilt Clause, Germany was forced to accept responsibility for initiating the war. Germany was ordered to demobilize large sections of its army, reducing its standing forces to no more than 100,000 troops. The Rhineland, Germany's shared western border with France and Belgium that was now occupied by forces from those countries, the United States and Britain, was to be completely demilitarized. All German military personnel and their equipment would leave the region. All German fortifications in the area were to be razed, and no new military installations were to be constructed there. Germany was ordered to pay reparations for damages and occupation costs to the Allied powers, the amount of which, roughly $5 billion, was not determined until 1921. Last but not least, Germany was forced to cede approximately 25,000 square miles of territory in Europe and turn over sovereignty of its overseas colonies to the League of Nations mandate system. Estimates vary, but nearly 7 million Germans living in Alsace-Lorraine, Mauritanie, Upan-Malmedy, Upper Silesia, Posen, sections of East Prussia, Pomerania, Memel, and the city of Danzig found themselves under the sovereignty of France, Belgium, the League of Nations, or the newly self-determined states of Poland and Czechoslovakia. The result was a protracted debate over the citizenship and nationality of these minority Germans, the so-called orphans of Versailles. In Africa, China, and the Pacific, the thousands of Germans living in the colonies received word that their colonial homelands were now reclassified as mandates of the League of Nations, to be administered by France, Belgium, Japan, Britain, and the British dominions of South Africa, Australia, and New Zealand. What immediately followed in each of the reclassified German colonies, with the exception of German Southwest Africa, was the direct expulsion and repatriation of all Germans and a liquidation of confiscated enemy property. Colonial Germans became yet another of the many groups of refugees and malcontents within Germany angered by the Treaty of Versailles and placing a cacophony of demands for restitution and accommodation on the Weimar State and the League of Nations. This audiobook supplements literature on imperialism, post-colonialism, internationalism, and modern Germany. My work revises customary historical interpretations of European imperial and post-colonial identities, the League of Nations' form of international governance, German participation in the League, the role of interest groups in international organizations and diplomacy, and liberal imperialism. I challenge these literatures by outlining the complex and fragmented nature of the post-imperial experience for various communities of colonial Germans, by seriously considering the role of the League of Nations as a form of international governance perceived by contemporaries as an opportunity for redress on the world stage, and by asserting that colonial Germans served not as a hindrance to the imperial internationalism of the mandate system, but as active supporters of and contributors to liberal interwar internationalism as the strongest option for the maintenance of empire in the 20th century. In outlining colonial Germans' substantial interwar-era investment in the League and its mechanisms as a means to preserve their individual imperial interests alongside those of other Europeans, I also complicate the recently popular narrative of a direct continuity between Germany's colonial period and the Nazi era. In this book, I place particular emphasis on how colonial officials, settlers, and colonial lobbies made use of the League of Nations framework. The German colonial advocates who are the focus of this monograph comprised not only those individuals who had been allowed to remain in the mandates as new subjects of the Allies, but also former colonial officials, settlers, and missionaries who were forcibly repatriated by the mandatory powers after the First World War. These Kolonialdeutsche, colonial Germans, had invested substantial time and money in German imperialism. I highlight how German men and women from the former African colonies exploited transnational opportunities to recover, renovate, and market their understandings of European colonial aims in order to reestablish themselves as experts and fellow civilizers in European and American discourses on nationalism and imperialism, and thereby transformed the global perception and structures of imperial governance as they situated themselves between colonizers and colonial subjects in a world of evolving colonial empires that were not their own. Starting in 1919, I investigate the involvement of former settlers and colonial officials in such diplomatic flashpoints as the naturalization controversy in South African-administered Southwest Africa and German participation in the Permanent Mandates Commission, PMC, from 1927 to 1933. I end my analysis in 1933 with an investigation of the involvement of one of Germany's former colonial governors in the League of Nations' commission sent to assess the Manchurian crisis between China and Japan. The caesura of 1918 to 1919, though creating the post-colonial environment in which Germany's new variants of imperial and national identity would emerge, represents an interruption of the running narrative of colonialism, but not a complete break with pre-colonial and colonial identities. For Germans, as for other European nationalities, to be European meant standing at the pinnacle of civilization. Being civilized, in turn, implied a need, duty, or right to expand that civilization to other parts of the world deemed uncivilized and savage. The final piece of this identity construction was a sentiment that empire made a national group truly European among their colonizing peers, since the concept of having civilizational superiority or being respectable was gained or reinforced through displays of dominance over others. This conception of Europeanness, as well as notions of race and gender from the colonial period, did not simply disappear with the loss of empire. International encounters with a plethora of understandings of the concept of nation, empire, and European remained crucial in efforts to locate and define Germanness in the interwar period. Despite a German history of renegotiating colonial selves, Germany is often overlooked in studies of imperial decline and of the impact of that post-colonial experience on European identities. Germany's disappearance from the colonial stage long before the events of the 1940s, 1950s, and 1960s that challenged British and French imperialism has contributed to its omission from the historiography of decolonization. Although the loss of the colonies far predated the assumed period of decolonization, post-war Germans, just like Frenchmen after Algerian independence, or Britons after the loss of India, modified colonial rhetoric and crafted a narrative of colonial loss in order to maintain the dimensions of their imperially constituted German national and European identities. Germany's experience as one of the first powers in the 20th century to lose its entire overseas empire, albeit under special circumstances, helped set the tone for how Europeans coped with the end of their colonial rule in Africa and Asia. Colonial Germans, having been so vocal and so public in their own renegotiations of identity without empire, ceded some of the thoughts, arguments, and policy decisions that later influenced other colonial European populations as they struggled to come to terms with the contradictions inherent in the civilizing mission and as they experienced imperial decline. Colonial Germans' efforts to adapt and adjust to the loss of colonies in order to maintain a presence in European imperial endeavors, both within the League of Nations and in broader public discourses, may also have had an effect on metropolitan France and Britain. Both of these states, which engaged in similar discourses as Germany over the nature of good colonial government in the international political environment after the Great War, are said to have invented decolonization or abdicated responsibility for their colonies in the second half of the 20th century. They refashioned their policies and self-understandings formed in the context of imperialism to secure global influence in new ways as their empires officially crumbled away. Investigating the German case will enable scholars to chart the trajectory of what Europeans perceived as imperial decline and colonial loss, as well as the impacts these experiences had on European societies and cultures over a much longer period of time, beginning earlier in the 20th century. In recent years, post-colonial Germans have garnered increased attention from scholars. Marcia Klotz and Jared Poley point to works of fiction as a way to indicate the broad influence of decolonization and post-colonial narratives of German identity. Their research is insightful, looking for currents of decolonization thought and rhetoric throughout Weimar society is an important first step in probing the particulars of continuity between Germany's colonial, Weimar, and Nazi periods. These works, however, seem too quick to overlook the writings and activities of political figures engaging directly with the loss of empire, particularly former colonial administrators and long-term settlers. Conversely, Uta Peuger has argued that representations of empire need to be understood in the context of decision-makers in business and politics. I would suggest that Peuger's argument holds just as true for representations of empire after the moment of imperialism had passed. Often these individuals had dedicated their entire adult lives to overseas imperialism. Some served for decades in the same colonies, others traveled from protectorate to protectorate, while still others commuted over the years between metropolitan and colonial offices. Just like Jared Poley's fiction writers and pamphleteers, the former colonial administrators tried to renegotiate what it meant to be German during an interruption of imperially constituted German identity. The most comprehensive work to date on how Germans came to terms with the loss of empire through memory is Britta Schilling's Post-Colonial Germany. Schilling explores the connections between public and private memories of Germany's colonial past. She charts the changes in Germany's collective memory of its overseas imperial endeavors from the Weimar era to the Nazi regime, and on into post-Second World War Germany and the later reunified Federal Republic of Germany. The focus in her work is the shifting relationship between memory and material culture in these various epochs. Schilling's work is integral to our understanding of Germany's colonial past as an ongoing process of memory construction that evolves and changes constantly long after the formal end of Germany's overseas imperialism. Yet in ambitiously trying to cover nearly a century of transformations in Germany's collective memory of colonialism, Schilling simplifies the Weimar era in order to move on to the later periods. She contends that the Weimar years are the time in which private and public memories of Germany's colonial past were most unified, and that the material culture created by colonial Germans in this period afforded them a dream state in which they could indulge in nostalgia for the former colonies without political repercussions. For Schilling, colonial Germans in the interwar period are passive actors, not directly engaging in domestic or international politics, but instead marketing the colonial experience to Germans as a shared memory and cultural heritage. I counter that it was in the Weimar era that the memory of Germany's colonial past is most fragmented and contested, especially among colonial Germans themselves. Colonial officials largely sought to whitewash German atrocities in the colonial era in the hopes of colonial restitution and doggedly defended Germany's colonial record. Some German missionary societies, on the contrary, acknowledged the atrocities and distanced themselves from the colonial administration in hopes of retaining the ability to proselytize in the new Allied-controlled mandates, bringing themselves into conflict with the German colonial lobbies that were dominated by former colonial officials. Finally, settlers were more concerned with remembering a better Germany in Africa. They distinguished their colonial Heimat from the European Germany, and rather than sharing it with other Germans, coveted their personal contributions to the colonial endeavor that had made their colonial homeland superior to a decadent and decaying metropole. Repatriated settlers desired to return to this truer Germany in the colonies, not only in dreams or memory, but in reality, even at the expense of their German citizenship and regardless of whether their former African homes were restored to German administration. Furthermore, none of these groups of colonial Germans shied away from political engagement. In domestic politics, colonial Germans' cultural representations of the colonial past were just part of an ongoing effort to receive some sort of government assistance to alleviate their various post-imperial plights. The Colonial Ball, the Africa Book, and the Colonial Week were festivities, publications, and public exhibitions full of dioramas of colonial life, parades, musical performances, and lectures from experts on the former colonies, and memorial celebrations for fallen German colonial soldiers intended to evoke nostalgia for the colonies among German citizens and politicians. Though not always sharing a common goal of colonial irredentism, these works and events often went hand in hand with direct political action by former colonial governors like Theodor Zeitz and Heinrich Ney, who rallied the colonial lobbies for routine demonstrations and letter-writing campaigns to encourage or shame the German government into pursuing colonial restitution. Colonial German political activity, however, was not limited to the domestic stage. The most frequent omission from recent works on post-colonial Germans concerns colonial German engagement with internationalism and the League of Nations. To develop a fuller picture of both the colonial Germans and international relations in the period of the League and the Mandate system, it is important to incorporate Germany's moment of colonial loss into the larger narrative of how Europeans confronted what they thought was the end of empire. The clearest evidence of colonial German contributions to the European narrative of fears of imperial decline can be seen in the ways in which Germans participated in transnational discussions of imperialism, ethnicity, and nationalism at the League of Nations. Until the 1990s, most of the scholarship on the League of Nations operated on the hindsight fallacy and was preoccupied with the League's failure to maintain general peace and to prevent the outbreak of the Second World War. This changed with the fall of the Soviet Union. New questions emerged about how international governance bodies like the United Nations could operate in a world politics environment with a single superpower, and how best to handle minorities within the former Soviet republics. In this context, historians began interrogating something other than the League's teleological trajectory to 1939, and instead investigated the League's intended roles, structures, and functionality. This study makes interventions into scholarship on the inner workings of the League of Nations by seriously considering its perceived capacity for international oversight and governance through close examination of the ways in which colonial Germans adapted to and participated in the political language and structure of the League as part of their efforts to use the international body and its principles to forward their individual and collective goals. Scholars like Zara Steiner have fleshed out the inner workings of the League and have come to the conclusion that it was never a form of international government, but was intended and used as an extension of diplomacy between the great powers. Steiner insists the League was only a mechanism for conducting multinational diplomacy whose success or failure depended upon the willingness of the states, particularly the most powerful states, to use it. Building on these notions, studies like those of Gerard Unger and Jonathan Wright focus on the chief diplomats of the great powers, investigating the backroom deals and relationships between prominent plenipotentiaries. In this light, the League is seen as nothing more than the occasionally effective plaything of diplomats and powerful states, instead of a body that engaged with a global community of peoples and groups. True as this may in part be, the League of Nations was seen by contemporaries as an earnest attempt at international governance and oversight. By keeping contemporary views of the League and its role in international mediation in mind, it is possible to understand how not only great powers, but also minority groups and lobbying interests believed they would have a hearing on the world stage through the mechanism of the League of Nations. Some of the most recent work has addressed how the League of Nations handled the protection of minorities in newly formed nations and mandates. Despite difference of opinion on the effectiveness of the League and its numerous committees in defending minority rights and overseeing governments, continental and colonial, these works share a tendency to center their narratives on the League or mandate-holding great powers. The more positive assessments of the League highlight the encouragement that minority communities may have received in the period by analyzing partially effective supervisory commissions, but still neglect aspects of the story that could only be told from the perspectives of the minorities themselves as these groups navigated the complexities of the League's bureaucracy. Unlike the current literature, which places more emphasis on the League and mandate-holding powers, this work operates from the point of view of a self-proclaimed minority group, Colonial Germans. The League's international public presence, though viewed as a weakness by Kurs and Reitz von Frenz, added to its legitimacy in the eyes of minority groups who yearned for a larger audience to tell of their plight and from which to seek sympathy and support. Hence, the present study investigates how colonial Germans understood their opportunities for international redress and how they pursued and employed these options. Although Susan Peterson's thorough work on the League mandate system includes a section where she addresses colonial German participation in the League, she, like much of the existing literature, labels colonial German activism within the League as revisionism intended to hinder British and French imperial interests. My book acknowledges that much of the activism was revisionist in nature, but contends that there was also genuine investment on the part of some colonial Germans in the League's new imperial framework and vision. Furthermore, my work argues that whether revisionist or supportive in the nature of their participation, colonial Germans served not as barriers to imperial interests in the League, but rather as co-narrators of the new discourse of imperial internationalism created by the mandate system. In the first chapters, I focus on the various strategies used by colonial Germans between 1919 and 1926 to further their cause, their appeals to the League, their petitions to the mandatory powers of Britain and South Africa, and their reactions to British, South African, and League responses to their pleas. For the years following Locarno, Germany's entry to the League, and the admission of a German to the PMC, my focus shifts from how colonial Germans sought redress to how Germans maintained a foothold in international discourses on imperialism, mandates, and nationalism in events that involved the League, such as the Manchurian crisis. By inserting themselves into larger transnational discussions on the definitions of empire, civilization, good colonial governance, and Europeanness, colonial Germans hope to create a new niche for themselves in other Europeans' colonial projects. Analyzing this minority group's engagement with transnational events and networks has the added benefit of exploring how a distinct fragment of German national identity not only emerged and interacted with competing notions of German identity domestically, but also managed to interface with and market itself to a dynamic international community. Colonial German involvement in the League, however, necessitated a shift in the vocabulary, political language, and rhetorical strategies of those Germans who chose to actively participate in the internationalism of the New World Order. The Allied powers justified the seizure of Germany's colonial holdings with accusations that Germany had militarized its colonies and had committed colonial atrocities, such as the German campaign against the Herero. As one German commentator recognized, Germany's failure in the field of colonial civilization had become all too apparent to leave 13 to 14 million natives again to the fate from which the war had liberated them. Germany's history in the colonies had indeed been blotted with a considerable amount of blood. There was, for instance, the highly publicized Peters scandal of 1892 to 1896 in German East Africa. Karl Peters, the German colonial explorer who had laid the groundwork for the foundation of German East Africa as a colony, was made Reichskommissar of the Kilimanjaro region in 1891. In 1892, Peters discovered that one of the local African women he used as a concubine was having a sexual affair with his manservant. Peters had both of them hanged and ordered their villages destroyed. Peters was recalled to Berlin in 1893, but his crimes were not made public until 1896, when Auguste Bebel, chairman of the SPD, read a self-incriminating letter of Peters before a session of the Reichstag and demanded a series of investigations that led to Peters being deprived of his commission. Ultimately, Peters evaded criminal prosecution by moving to the United Kingdom to serve as a colonial expert for the British Empire in Rhodesia. Nonetheless, Peters's wrathful vengeance had resulted not only in the destruction of two African communities, but also led to a series of small rebellions by the Chaga of East Africa that were brutally put down by German forces in the colony. Yet another example of Germany's colonial violence was the Maji Maji Rebellion of 1905 to 1907, in which several indigenous communities in the East African colony violently resisted head taxes, hut taxes, and a scheme that coerced the indigenous population to grow cotton for export. This African resistance was viciously suppressed by German colonial troops, resulting in the deaths of thousands of African subjects in German East Africa. While there are several other instances of violent repression of indigenous groups under the rule of the German Empire, the suppression of the Herero and Nama resistance movements in Southwest Africa from 1904 to 1907 is the most notorious instance of bloodshed in the German colonies. In response to ever more restrictive land policies imposed upon them by the German colonial state, ongoing railway construction through tribal lands, and decades of violent encounters with German settlers and German colonial troops, the indigenous Ova Herero, Herero, and the Nama, Khoisan, Khoikhoi communities rose up in open rebellion in 1904. The German general sent to put down the rebellion, Lothar von Trotha, enacted martial law in the colony, and on October 2, 1904, issued his infamous annihilation order, stating that every Herero man, woman, and child must either leave Southwest Africa or be killed. Though appraisals of the final death toll vary, the war was nonetheless devastating to the Herero and Nama. Between 1904 and 1907, large percentages of both populations were killed in the fighting, in the concentration camps the Germans used for African prisoners of war, and in a desperate flight by several Herero into the Omaheke, Kalahari Desert, in an attempt to escape Trotha's war machine. The Allies argued that these acts of colonial violence set the Germans apart. Germans were cast as incomparable in their brutality and un-European in their dealings with natives and in the conduct of war in the colonial theater. With the taint of colonial guilt, Germans were deemed exceptionally cruel colonial masters and unfit imperialists. Germany was therefore barred from recovering its colonies by way of becoming a mandatory power itself, a status the Allies insisted the Germans would not be allowed to attain in the new League of Nations mandate system. In short, Germany was publicly ostracized from the work of the civilizing mission. This fact presented a challenge to German national and European identities, one to which many Germans felt the need to respond, above all, the colonial Germans themselves. Given the huge level of not only financial but also cultural and moral investment that many Europeans had placed in colonialism, it is hardly surprising that colonial Germans were indignant at being excluded from the civilizing mission with the stigma of atrocity. Empire and the othered colonized subject had both played roles in European self-identification, including German identity construction, for at least two centuries prior to the Treaty of Versailles. The Enlightenment gave birth to a plethora of ideological frameworks on social and economic development. Edward Said outlined how Anglo-French scholars and explorers regularly engaged in the creation of imaginary geographies and false representations of the Middle East and Asia for centuries in an effort to orientalize the Oriental, to define boundaries and differences with the Oriental other, not just to understand the peoples they encountered, but to categorize them and claim superiority over them. Despite Said's dismissal of German participation in the creation of Orientalism and imperial thinking, Suzanne Marchand points out that Germans made key contributions to the stadial theory of development, particularly in the area of Orientalist religious scholarship. Germany, being home to some of the preeminent scholars on Middle Eastern languages and Sanskrit, as well as the religions of Judaism, Islam, Hinduism, Buddhism, and Confucianism, contributed simultaneously to theological and racial treatises stemming from imperial experience. The experience of missionaries and religious scholars was an important ingredient in the formation of racial thinking during empire throughout Europe. Missionaries have, since the work of Komarov and Komarov, often been viewed as the shock troops of colonialism. While such terminology has been hotly contested at times in post-colonial scholarship, it is hard to deny the role missionaries intentionally or unintentionally played in creating the cultural encounter dialogues that led to the subjugation of other peoples at the hands of Europeans. European missionaries were often the first to give detailed histories, geographic studies, and ethnographic assessments of cultural structures of and relations between indigenous populations in Africa, Asia, the Americas, the Pacific, and Australia, generating vital information for would-be colonial planners. The evangelical concept of heathenism, used by missionaries to describe non-Christian religious beliefs and cultural norms, became an integral component of European discourse to legitimate their rule over non-Europeans by pointing to a perceived lack of morals and backwardness on the part of their colonized subjects. John Komaroff and Susan Thorne argue that European missionaries, particularly British missionaries, helped to conflate racial discourses with those on class. These scholars contend that the class baggage that missionaries carried with them from Europe, chiefly a rhetorical basis for hierarchy, status, and position, fed into a racial nomenclature that facilitated not only a view of colonized subjects as the less fortunate in need of assistance from a better class, but also a justification for the rule of difference. As time went on, European missionaries and religious scholars even aided in the creation of a progressivist stepping stone assessment of different cultures, ranking those with more religious structure, monotheism, and a written language, easing the process of biblical translation, as more advanced and closer to civilization, even if they weren't quite European. Karl Becker, a German religious scholar who specialized in Islamic studies at the turn of the 20th century, even went so far as to suggest conversion of colonial subjects to Islam as a positive step on a path toward their final conversion to Christianity. The stadial theory of society developed in this multifaceted intellectual atmosphere eventually postulated that each society passed through a similar history in terms of its internal constitution, going through numerous steps of organization based on the mode of subsistence until arriving at the highest stage. Europe, of course, sat at the pinnacle of this flowchart of human society. Africa's primitiveness was set against Europe's modernity as a Foucaultian other. With putative superiority came equally putative responsibility, and Europeans began to feel a sense of duty toward the infant savages of Africa and saw it as their duty to mold these primitives into men of virtue and to shape the land deemed vacant of civilization into an economically productive paradise. Although it took on many different forms in Britain, France, Spain, the Netherlands, and later Germany, Italy, and the United States, this new civilizing mission was merged with mercantilist and later capitalist ideologies to justify colonialism. The emergence of nationalism and the nation-state also incorporated imperialism as an important component of national identity, in which nation-states were duty-bound to uplift their less developed neighbors and colonial holdings economically and culturally, while simultaneously using these cultures as anthropological lenses to understand Europe's own past stages of development. The stadial view was even incorporated into ethnographic presentations to the public in museums, where exhibits in German and other European ethnographic institutes drew parallels between non-Western cultures and early hominids or tribal groups that were the precursors to European civilization. Christian missionaries, though they contributed to racial discourses, wholly supported the abolition of slavery and often had a mercurial relationship of support for and from European colonial administrations, along with critique of colonial practices. Still, Christian missionaries hoped that imperialism, if properly guided, would provide the infrastructure needed to give natives a European example to follow in culture, morals, education, and even civil engineering that would in turn influence them to follow Christ. The European movement for the abolition of slaving, pushed heavily by segments of the British population throughout the 19th century and formally pronounced as law in 1848, began an international conversation from at least the Congress of Vienna, 1814 to 1815, forward, over whether and how to engage in a less exploitative form of empire by ending the slave trade and focusing on tutelage of indigenous populations toward Enlightenment precepts of humanity and development. Although state violence and coerced labor in the colonies did not go uncontested in the public sphere of many Western metropoles, in many cases, violent repression and even extermination of supposedly lazy indigenous populations were justified by the ends of spreading civilization in this liberal imperial paradigm. The First World War, however, marked a shift in the West's enunciations of liberal imperialist principles. As Mark Mazower has argued, a new statement of the justification for imperialism needed to be formulated if the standard of civilization via Western domination were to be maintained in the face of movements that had become a greater threat to empire following the First World War. Pan-Africanism, Pan-Arabism, and Pan-Islam, as well as individual nationalist movements in various colonies, challenged the rhetoric of the European stadial theory of development with an adopted and modified Wilsonian political language of liberty and self-determination for all. Mazower contends that imperialism was extended in a new, far less overt manner than a simple extension of 19th-century colonialism. To satisfy European and American public opinion, the mission of civilizing the world was retooled as an international program of tutelage, raising colonial subjects toward the eventual promised formation of their own nation-states. To many, internationalism seemed the most likely path to a permanent peace and to the fulfillment of the democratic ambitions of anti-colonialists who had limited political representation in nation-states and empires. New international governmental structures opened up new opportunities for representation, petition, and redress for minority and subaltern groups wishing to challenge the status quo. Yet internationalism was not intended as the destroyer of empires, but as the civilizer of the civilizing mission. Nonetheless, the Allies' use of colonial guilt as grounds for the seizure of Germany's colonies and the creation of the League's mandate system initiated a discussion of what constituted humane imperialism and good colonial governance, the new hallmarks of the civilized nation engaged in the work of empire, that would bring the hypocrisies of liberal imperialism to the forefront of the international public sphere. Combating allegations of colonial guilt thus became a necessary first step for Germans to any potential progress in recovery of the overseas empire and their imperially based notions of Europeanness. To do so, colonial Germans appropriated the new political language of liberal imperial internationalism. Here, the notion of ideas in context, advocated by Quentin Skinner, provides a useful framework. Skinner's theories on textual analysis urge that assessment of how political language translates into political action, and vice versa, should be derived from the context of the period and a careful breakdown of what politically engaged authors intended to accomplish in writing a piece amid the give and take of political debate. This approach insightfully emphasizes, as well, how dominant political languages of a period both constrain and empower those who engage with them. In efforts to maintain their careers and imperial/national conceptions of the self, German colonial officials and settlers argued against the idea of colonial guilt and reasserted German Europeanness in a world where empire, or at least the civilizing mission, was an essential component of this identity. They engaged with the new political vocabulary of empire and civilization made normative by the Allies and the League, using it in conventional ways to legitimate past actions and to reassert German Europeanness, as well as manipulating it to claim moral superiority and political advantage in the specific questions of the day. As Glenda Sluga argues, it is important to remember that the concept of the international in the 20th century developed out of the same questions of modernity, governance, and political idealism faced in the age of nationalism. Debates over citizenship, individual liberties, national identity, democracy, and many others. Nationalism and internationalism both drew heavily on the same Enlightenment concepts relating to the promise of evolving political, economic, social, and cultural progress that had been key components in imperialism's stadial theory of development. Therefore, the new political language of internationalism embodied in the League of Nations shared a heritage and was in constant dialogue with political discourses on empire, colonialism, and even national identity, easing the transition for colonial Germans who sought to engage with the political languages of the post-Versailles world order. Mazower contends that the League and its political discourse of imperial internationalism was largely the brainchild of thinkers within the British Empire. Others, such as Erez Manella, point to the American president Woodrow Wilson as the source for the political language used in the interwar debates over nationalism, imperialism, self-determination, and colonial liberation. Although well-known figures such as Jan Smuts, Alfred Zimmern, and Woodrow Wilson certainly played key roles in the development of a vocabulary of liberal and imperial internationalism in the 1920s, neither they nor the leaders and diplomats of the Allied powers, nor even the bureaucrats at the helm of the League, were the sole contributors to the ongoing evolution of imperial internationalist discourse and its forms. As Brian Vick has argued in the case of the Congress of Vienna, the peace settlement which ended the Napoleonic Wars that had engulfed Europe in the late 18th and early 19th centuries, it is necessary to go beyond the usual canon of societal elites and statesmen when analyzing the diplomacy and political wrangling of the League over issues of imperialism and the mandate system. Throughout the interwar period, the League became increasingly prominent as the site where international public opinion engaged with diplomacy and political action. It was, for a time in the 20th century, one of the key venues where what Vick has called influence politics was practiced. For this reason, it is important to look not only at the great men of the period when analyzing how the political discourses on imperialism, the mandate system, internationalism, and good colonial governance were continually modified and codified. Ordinary citizens of numerous states, even the supposedly ostracized colonial Germans, injected themselves into these discussions through their writings, through the media, through their social and professional networks, and through their cultural and political activities. Individual German settlers and former colonial officials, and especially German colonial interest groups, attempted to sway public opinion in their favor by using important political languages of the time, above all that of liberal internationalism, to reinsert themselves into the European civilizing mission in dialogue, and in some cases in praxis. Whether successful or not, when German colonial lobbies attempted to use the media and political and social networks to achieve colonial restitution, statesmen, diplomats, and governments were forced to respond to and mollify manipulations of domestic and international public opinion concerning German colonialism and colonial restitution. As I have demonstrated in a previously published article, this was most significantly the case at the 1925 Locarno Conference. The 1926 admission of Germany to the League of Nations, the induction of two of Germany's former colonial officials to the PMC between 1927 and 1933, and the involvement of Heinrich Schnee, Germany's most vocal colonial irredentist on the League's Manchurian Commission, are all examples of colonial Germans becoming empowered by appropriating the then-dominant political language of imperial internationalism in hopes of ensuring their ongoing contribution to Europe's colonial endeavors. The participation of colonial Germans in an international agency meant to oversee the management of their former colonies and their willingness to appropriate the political languages of internationalism and liberal imperialism also raise new questions about continuity between the German colonial state and the Nazi regime. There has been a great deal of scholarship on the perseverance of German imperialist thinking and ambitions into the Nazi era, particularly in recent years. Following the public recognition by a German government official in 2004 of the atrocities that occurred in the early 20th century in what is now Namibia, scholars such as Isabel Hall and Jürgen Zimmerer drew upon the Herero genocide of 1904 to 1907 and the brutal repression of the Maji-Maji rebellion of 1905 to 1907 to tell a story of Germany's unique penchant for military extremism practiced and perfected in its colonial experience. Hall makes blanket statements about the militancy of German nationalism and the population as a whole, arguing that the importance of the military as a symbol of the nation generated a military culture that prized the necessity of winning by any means, resulting in escalating brutality toward those classed as enemies. Using the somewhat tenuous connection to the Armenian genocide, she argues that this pattern produced the disregard for life and the humanity of others displayed during the Holocaust.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.